Thursdays, we talk hoops, Sixers, Nets last night. Keith Smith at Keith Smith NBA. Yahoo Sports covers the NBA, does an excellent job. And he, like all guests, appears via the Boardwalk Honda Hotline. Let's get into it, Keith, because a lot of people talking about the battle for number one last night that the Nets apparently didn't care too much about.
Yeah, I think the Nets have made it kind of clear that they are viewing it as health over seed. They're not apparently very worried about having to go through both Milwaukee and Philadelphia if that's the way things line up. So they're content to make sure that their guys are ready to go. And I think Philadelphia did a good job of taking advantage last night and getting that win, because I get where the Nets are coming from. Health should trump all other things. But you really want to be that number one seed in the East. You do not want to have to play two of those other teams and have to try to get through them. You want to make your path easier if at all possible.
Yeah, there's no question. I mean, if you're the two or the three, you're going to have to face that team in the second round. The one seed is going to get the four, most likely the 4-5 winner. It's definitely a different and easier pass. And then if you're the two or the three, you're going to have to go and play that seventh game possibly in Philadelphia, where they are a much better team. I mean, this year they're much better on the road, but I don't know the mindset there. But I want to ask you, Keith, you follow the league in general, not just the Sixers. Is this an NBA problem that they are going to have to look at, or is there one of those things where they got to just put their palms up and say, hey, this is what it is?
Yeah, I think this year, especially given all of the injuries we've seen and the COVID concerns and things like that, this is where you just kind of say, hey, it is what it is. We understand teams are, you know, prioritizing what they need to get there health-wise. We're not going to do anything about this. Long-term, yeah, it's the issue we've kind of always talked about. It goes really back to those Spurs teams when they, you know, started, very frequently sitting guys like Tim Duncan and Tony Parker and Manu Ginobili, because they were looking at it as, hey, we're in this thing for a marathon, not a sprint, and winning every possible regular season game just isn't a real thing we're looking to do. So you can see both sides of it, but I think in the end, you want to have teams at their best in the playoffs, and if this is how we get there, this is how we get there.
Well, I mean, I could see that point is, hey, Milwaukee ran out to 60-plus wins. Atlanta's done it in the past, and they get knocked out. That's one thing. Having the option of playing for the number one seed and sitting your guys out, as opposed to saying, hey, we could have done it Monday night against Minnesota. We have Philadelphia on Wednesday. Let's sit them out against Minnesota and go after Philly. I mean, so there are strategical ways you can do it, no?
Yeah, there definitely is. I think what you kind of almost look at it like is, now you hope if you're the Nets, you believe, hey, we can beat Minnesota even without our guys. But I think you're probably looking at it as, why are we going to risk that in the Philadelphia game? Because we knew James Harden was going to be out anyway. In the Philadelphia game, if we get there, that one's more of a toss-up even with our guys playing. Let's make sure we get the assured win, and then we'll kind of play it out and see how it goes against Philly. And I'm guessing that was the decision-making from Steve Nash and all parties involved.
All right, Keith Smith, what, if anything, did you take from that game then last night with a half a Nets team against that Sixers team? It was a 22-point game. The Nets' second unit kind of got back into the game. The Sixers had to put their starters back in. They didn't really seem like they were all that ready to get back into that game. But what did you take, if anything, from Sixers-Nets? Because a lot of people were looking forward to this. Like, all right, let's see how these two match up. They're tied for first, but the Nets have been undermanned all year. They have not played with the big three but eight times. Did you get anything from that game last night?
Yeah, the couple takeaways that I had out of it were, first is, the Nets have no answer for Joel Embiid. And not that anybody has a real good answer for him, but the Nets really have nothing. There's just nothing that they can do. And, you know, I like to call it, this is a new Embiid. He is now playing deeper into games, playing better. He's in better shape. He looks better deeper into these games. And that's really hard to handle, because he used to be, all right, let him get his 35, 40 points by the end of the third quarter. And then in the fourth quarter, he'll be exhausted and he'll just, be floating around the perimeter, launching up jump shots. And he's not necessarily that guy, that he was the last few years. So I think that's the problem. On the other end, it's been a problem for Philadelphia for a number of years now, and I continue to think it's still an issue. They don't have an answer for quick scoring point guards. guys who are going to have the ball in their hand a lot. Kyrie Irving, he's an offensive dynamo anyway, but he had a really nice game, and that's been a problem for Philly. And there's a chance, you may see a handful of guys like that throughout the playoffs, and that's going to be something that they're going to have to try to get some kind of answer for. I don't really know if it's, do you play Matisse Thybul more? Do you maybe go to Tyrese Maxey on occasion? That's a little tough, and it's hard to envision Doc Rivers trusting a rookie to play major playoff minutes, but that is something I've got my eye on.
What about Hill when he's ready to play? Can he be that guy?
Yeah, I think so to some extent. It's really hard to count on anything from George Hill at this point when you haven't seen him really all season long. You haven't, or it's been a month since we've seen him. Haven't seen him at all for Philadelphia. So hopefully that's what he'll give them, is a guy who's, at least a little bit better of a defensive option against those smaller, quicker guards. But that's, you're asking a lot of a veteran guy to say, hey, go in there and be kind of our shutdown defensive guy. And, the nice thing is if Hill can do that, he gives you a little bit more balance because he can make some shots. He's going to move the ball the right way. Where with Thybul and Maxey, that's still a lot more of a question mark.
Keith Smith, Yahoo Sports, covers the NBA at Keith Smith NBA. Danny Green said something interesting after the game. I don't know what the NBA would think about this. He said, when I was in San Antonio, sometimes we didn't play everybody so that teams didn't know how to guard us or how to play us. Does the league want to hear that?
Yeah, I don't think they really want to hear that, but I don't think they want to hear anything that involves not playing guys. But there is truth to that. There's a big belief in don't show anybody anything in the regular season. That's been kind of a hallmark of a number of teams going deep into history over the last, let's call it 15 or so years. We're just not going to show you much because we're more concerned about that we have an upper hand when we get to the playoffs. There's a strong belief every year. There's teams that you mentioned, Milwaukee before, Utah this year, these teams that kind of run out, they win a whole bunch of games, and then if they can't get it done in the playoffs, you start to look at it and say, well, did you show everything you had? And now there's all sorts of film, and teams get a sense of who you are and a better idea of defending you versus, these teams that, they kind of play a little bit of possum and lay back a little bit in the regular season, and that can work at times too. So I get what Danny Green is saying, that there is something to that.
Yeah, and I know that the Sixers last night, they basically played everybody except George Hill, who hasn't played yet, and Dwight Howard, their backup center, was not in that game. The Nets, of course, were missing a whole bunch of guys, so it was unfortunate there. The Bucks, though, so everybody's talking Nets is certainly the favorite for many. And a lot of people think because the Sixers doing what they do. Where, in terms of closeness, are the Bucks right there? Are they better than either one of those teams? And we're not talking about it. I feel like the Bucks are kind of the team that, hey, they've won all these games, they haven't won. And now this year they're lesser, and then people aren't talking about them as much. But where do you put them in ranking them with Philly and Brooklyn?
It all depends on the health of Giannis Antetokounmpo. It started to worry me over the last week or so that he is still not back. I think we're on about 2.5 weeks now or so of him missing games due to knee soreness. And guy misses the game here, misses the game there. Okay, that's, understandable. That's a management kind of thing. But when guys are missing this long, that starts to say to me, boy, there could be something bigger there. And this just worries me. Is this going to be one of those things where he gets back, plays, for a week, and then he's all of a sudden out again for, another week and those kind of things. But if he's healthy, if this is just, hey, we understand, the last couple of years winning all those games didn't do much for us. So we're prioritizing health and having everybody ready. If that's where they're at, I have them right on par with Brooklyn and Philadelphia just because Giannis is that good. And I think for the Bucks, less is more. They've got, instead of having 12, good NBA rotation players, they've got about 8 guys now that you feel like are really good rotation players. They can really rely on those guys. They've upped the minutes limits for guys like Giannis and Middleton, and Drew Holiday's playing, a good amount of minutes, so they should be able to step those guys up to 35, 40 minutes a night in the playoffs, which they couldn't do last season. So I think you add all those things up, and Milwaukee's going to be a really tough team. But if Giannis isn't healthy and right, they're a team that you can very easily see teams start jockeying to get into the, sixth seed to try to, think, all right, that's our way to get through the first round of the playoffs.
LaMarcus Aldridge abruptly retired today. It was a health reason that he did so. Does that impact the Nets? I mean, I guess we didn't get to see him all that much there, but was that a guy they were counting on? Or does it actually help them in the long run? I really think Claxton's a better fit for them, against, especially against Philly.
Yeah, I agree with you on Claxton. I was very concerned when they signed Blake Griffin and started talking about playing him at the five a lot, that you were going to see Claxton lose minutes there. Then they kind of doubled down on that with Aldridge, and Claxton did start to lose some minutes. But they really kind of excised DeAndre Jordan from the rotation. And it was, all right, you know, Claxton's still going to get his 15 minutes a night. They're just going to come off the bench, and it's only probably going to be about 15. So now what probably happens is Jordan's probably a bigger part of the rotation moving forward, and then Claxton's probably going to be in there for, you know, maybe 22, 25 minutes a night. And I don't know that LaMarcus Aldridge, at the state he was in, is a major loss for that Nets team, because he was far more of an offensive impact than he was a defensive impact, and they've already got all sorts of offense. What you do lose is you could kind of throw it into him on second units and kind of play through him and say, all right, you know, go to the left block and do what you've done for 15 years. And, you know, and he can still get your baskets there. But at this point, yeah, he wasn't going to be a guy, I think, that was going to have a huge impact in a meaningful playoff series. So I don't know that it's all that big of a loss on court for them.
All right, Keith Smith, we'll leave you with this, obviously. What is your take? A lot of talk about this play-in, matchups, the playoff implications, the Dallas and Cuban mentioning, and the fact that what do you think about the NBA sticking with that play-in format?
Yeah, I don't mind the play-in tournament itself. I do wish they'd done what they did in the bubble, which was stick with the standings qualifier. I think if a team is five games or more behind, they should just be out. You haven't done enough at that point to make the playoffs. And I know, you know, people will scream and yell, well, injuries and all these other things. Injuries happen every year to every team. But I don't mind the idea of the play-in, because I do think it's kind of given new life to some of these teams that at this point in a normal season would have turned and started, let's put it politically correct, reprioritizing the rest of the season, or, you know, call it what it is, tanking. They would have been, you know, going that route. But so I like that part of it. So that part is, you know, interesting to me. I hope the NBA sticks with this for, you know, 2-3 years, so we get a real sense of how do teams approach the trade deadline. Do teams care about, you know, all right, we'll get into the play-in, we'll win our way in there, and then we'll, you know, see what we can do? Or a team's going to get to the play-in and be like, we don't really care if we get in. We'd rather have the, you know, lottery pick, and if we get bounced, we get bounced. So that's going to be something interesting to monitor. But this one-year sample in this weird season is not going to be enough. So we've got to, you know, run this thing for a couple, you know, maybe 2-3 years, really start to get a good sense of, you know, well, what does this look like before we can make final decisions. But I like it. I just wish they'd make a couple tweaks.
All right. That's down the stretch we come. About 19, 18 games left for many of these teams. Sixers right now, one seat in the East. The matchups in the East would be interesting. Sixers, Hornets, they're the eight if the play-in games and whatever happens there. Nets, Heat, that would be interesting. Bucks, Knicks, and then Hawks, Celtics. So the Celtics have been playing much better. I'll leave you. I know you cover and watch a lot of Celtics. They've won 4 in a row, 7 out of 10. Are they starting to get it right?
Yeah, they really are, and they've been, you know, pretty good since the All-Star break-ish. They came out a little bit rough right after, but they've been playing pretty well, been playing really well this month. And I think what it is, a lot of it comes down to they finally got healthy. They've got their guys back. Their rotation is filled out a little bit more. They haven't had Evan Fournier, who, you know, by all accounts, it sounds like, unfortunately, has COVID. So we'll see when he returns to the lineup. Hopefully that'll be sooner rather than later for them. But yeah, the Celtics, all the pieces are kind of falling into the right places now. Guys aren't having to be asked to do more and those kind of things. And just like he did last year, at a similar point in the season, games-wise, Jason Tatum is really taking off and kind of going nuclear. And it's to the point where it's getting to be a question of, can anybody stop this guy? And that's a big part of what allowed Boston to make that run to the Eastern Conference Finals, was he was so good, even despite the pause in the season, when they restarted and then in the playoffs. So that's something that, you know, I think think Celtics fans are starting to finally see the team they thought they might see this year. It just took kind of a long, winding road to get there.
And real quick, Atlanta, they've been holding on to the 4-7-10, 3 in a row. McMillan has really changed things for that Hawks team. Are they someone to keep an eye on?
Yeah, I think so, because they've been doing it with all sorts of injuries. They have had a lot of guys out. Recently, it's been Trae Young and John Collins have been out. Their young forward duo of DeAndre Hunter and Cam Reddish have missed considerable time. They've never seen Chris Dunn this season. Danilo Gallinari, one of their key free agent acquisitions, missed a lot of time. Bogdan Bogdanovich missed a lot of time early in the year. So that's what's really impressive about this. And under Nate McMillan, they look a lot more organized. They look a lot more together. They're really executing fairly well defensively, which is a big improvement for them because they were not a very good defensive team. And when you have a guy like Trae Young, he can cause you a lot of problems. As an opponent, just because you've got to pick him up anywhere from inside half court. So that bends your defense in a way you may be a little bit uncomfortable. So, yeah, they're definitely a team to keep an eye on. If they can get through that first round, if you're Philly or Brooklyn or, if Milwaukee can get up to the one seed, the Hawks aren't a team you necessarily really want to play in the second round because they're young. They're going to be kind of playing with nothing to lose. And Trae Young is just so good. He's going to give you kind of, it's just going to be more kind of trouble in the second round than you really want to deal with. It's just going to be a little bit of a headache, and that's going to be something to definitely keep an eye on moving forward.
Yep, I agree with you there. They're a fun team. They're an interesting team and a team you probably don't want to match up with in those Eastern Conference playoffs. Keith Smith at Keith Smith NBA. The NBA playoffs about a month and a half away, and he, like all guests, appeared via the Boardwalk Honda Hotline. Keith, take care, pal.
Absolutely. Thank you. You all stay safe, you and yours.
All right, there he goes. Keith Smith, like all guests, appeared via the Boardwalk Honda Hotline. He'll be back next week as the Sixers. He'll be on Thursday when the Sixers get ready to take on the Milwaukee Bucks. That one should be interesting. They have back-to-back against the Bucks next week.